Hello, Year 8s. Welcome to a review on fields and forces. I know that this topic can be long, so I've made the table of contents interactive. Once you have gone through this PowerPoint once, if there is a section you would like to revisit, click on the title and it will bring you to the appropriate slides. Quick revision on the idea of scalar quantity and vector quantity. A scalar quantity only has a magnitude, so this means it only has a size or amount. These can be things such as distance, volume, or speed. A vector quantity still has magnitude, but it also has a direction attached. These can be quantities such as forces or velocity. You may hear the terms speed and velocity interchangeably from time to time. The difference is that speed is a scalar quantity that measures how much distance is covered in a specific amount of time. This means that it doesn't matter which direction an object is going, only how fast it is moving. Velocity is a vector quantity that also measures how much distance is covered in a specific amount of time. However, it takes into account the direction that the object is moving. We can calculate the speed or velocity of an object through the use of a formula or distance time graphs. The formula for speed is distance divided by time. We can rearrange this formula to help us solve for time or distance as well. Time would be equal to our distance divided by speed, where distance is equal to our speed times our time. To the left is an example of a distance time graph. It is used to illustrate an object's change in position over time. Time can be found on the x-axis, while the y-axis shows us distance. If we wanted to figure out how far a runner traveled in 10 seconds, we could use the distance time graph by finding 10 seconds on our x-axis, following the grid lines up to the runner's path, and following across to our y-axis. We can see from this that in 10 seconds, the runner was able to travel 50 meters. We can also use the graph to discover how long it takes the runner to travel a certain distance. In this case, how long did it take the runner to travel 100 meters? We would find 100 meters along our y-axis and following across until we hit our runner's path, then down to the x-axis, where you would see that it took the runner 20 seconds to travel that 100 meters. But what about speed? To find the speed of the runner using our distance time graph, we need to introduce our formula for speed. If we wanted to see what the runner's speed was at 20 seconds, we would need both the time, which we are given, as well as the distance he traveled in that time. From the previous slide, we know that it takes the runner 20 seconds to travel 100 meters. Remember, this was found by going to our x-axis, where we have 20 seconds. We follow up until we hit the runner's path, and then across to our y-axis, where it says 100 meters. We then substitute these values into our formula. Our distance is 100 meters. Our time is 20 seconds. 100 meters divided by 20 seconds gives us 5 meters per second. That means that the runner was traveling at a speed of 5 meters every second. Most distance time graphs that you will see have three main types of lines. There is a diagonal upward line that shows the object moving away from its starting point at a constant speed. Now, constant speed means that this object isn't slowing down or speeding up. It's staying the same. We have the diagonal downward line that shows the object moving towards its starting point, again at a constant speed. We also have a flat horizontal line that tells us that the object is not moving. We can see this because the distance does not change as time goes on. If we put all three lines together, you could see distance time graphs that look like this. We have an object moving away from its starting point before it stops for a while and then returns back to its original position. This could represent someone going to the grocery store to buy essential foods, staying at the store for a bit while they shop, and then returning home. Comparing distance time graphs. On the graph, we are shown two different lines. Both tell me that the objects are traveling away from their starting point at constant speeds. But which one is going quicker? Well, the green object is. We know this because the line is steeper than the red line. You could also figure this out by looking at some of the data given on the graph. If we look at the 2-hour mark, the green object has managed to travel 40 kilometers, while the red object has only gone about 20. If we put everything we just learned together, we can answer many different questions, such as, which of the two objects is moving quicker? And how do you know without solving? In this case, we have a purple and a green object. The purple line is far steeper than any point on the green line, so we can say that the purple object is traveling quicker. What is the speed of the green object moving between 6 seconds and 10 seconds? This one is a little bit trickier as we are only working with a small portion of the graph. Remember, to figure out speed, we need the distance and the time. To figure out the distance, we take the difference between where the object was at 6 seconds and where it was at 10. At 10 seconds, the object is at 7 meters, and at 6 seconds, it's at 6 meters. That means we can get our distance by taking away 6 from 7. That gives us 1 meter. Next up is time. The difference between 10 seconds and 6 seconds is going to be 4 seconds. We now have our distance and our time. We can use these in our speed equation, which is distance divided by time. So we have 1 meter divided by 4 seconds. By doing the math, we should be getting 0.25 meters per second. Therefore, between 6 and 10 seconds, this green object has a speed of 0.25 meters per second. Relative motion is the change in position with time of one object compared to another object. We can see this happening when you are traveling in a car. The cars that are passing you by often appear to move slowly past you, even though you know that the actual speeds of the cars are far quicker. Or if a car is moving towards you, it may feel as though they are speeding. To figure out the relative motion of an object moving in the same direction, you take the object that is moving the quickest and take away the object that is moving slower. For example, if two cars are traveling in the same direction on a road, the blue car is traveling 25 meters per second in front of the red car, which is traveling at 30 meters per second. The relative motion would be the speed of the quicker car, 30 meters per second, take away the slower, which is 25 meters per second. If we do this, we get a relative speed of 5 meters per second. If the two objects are moving in opposite directions, we add the two speeds together. If two cars were traveling in opposite directions, the blue car traveling 30 meters per second and the red car traveling at 25 meters per second, we can find the relative speed by adding our 30 plus our 25. This gives us 55 meters per second. An object can only move if there is a force acting on them. However, we know that there is always more than one force acting on an object at any given time. When forces are not equal in size, we can say that they are unbalanced. The overall force that is acting on an object can be found from those unbalanced forces, and we call it the resultant force. If we look at the image of the truck, we see that there is a force of 100 newtons pulling it to the right and 60 newtons pulling it to the left. To figure out the resultant force, we find the difference between the forces pulling in opposite directions. In this case, we would have 100 newtons take away 60 newtons. This gives us 40 newtons. This 40 newtons will be pulling the truck in the direction of the bigger force. In this case, it would be to the right. This means that the truck is speeding up towards the right. What happens if the resultant force is zero? Well, this is what we call balanced forces. In this case, we have 60 newtons pulling right and left. This means that our truck is either not moving at all, or it is moving at a constant speed, since there is no extra pull in one direction or the other.